next speaker is Heidi Peltier. She's Assistant Research Professor of Political Science and Director of the Cost of War Project at Boston University. She's going to talk about the Green New Deal and the green jobs it can create.
Looking at spending alternatives, as Laura mentioned, there's some movement in Congress right now for a 10% defense budget cut. Last year, in debating the National Defense Authorization Act, there were 93 votes to cut defense spending by 10%. There is currently a defense spending reduction caucus in the House. And again, a 10% budget cut is being discussed. Now, this is a good start, but not nearly enough. But the 10% budget cuts that are being discussed are based on cutting back waste and fraud and weapon systems that are no longer needed, that are outdated, and the opportunities to create even bigger cuts in the defense budget without jeopardizing national security. There are opportunities to go beyond 10%, but 10% is at least a good start. And areas to shift spending to, I won't go into detail on any of these estimates, but one area is infrastructure, and the American Society of Civil Engineers estimates that to get all types of infrastructure in the U.S., including transportation and water and school buildings and energy and waste management, all of our infrastructure systems that are below what they call a B average. They have a report card for infrastructure they put out every year. To get all of our infrastructure up to a B average would cost about $260 billion a year. Healthcare, obviously there are lots of different ways to address the deficits in our healthcare system. One plan would be to extend coverage in the current system to uninsured Americans, and that would cost about $149 billion a year. Education, again, short of an overhaul of the educational system, one small dent in that would be to subsidize pre-K for poor families, which has been shown to be a very successful anti-poverty tool. And that would cost about $41 billion. And what I'll spend a little more time talking about today is green growth. I worked on a study with the Political Economy Research Institute at UMass a few years ago in which we look at green growth in the U.S., we look at what it would cost to achieve a 40% emissions reduction over 20 years. And the total cost is about $200 billion a year for 20 years to achieve those emissions reductions. The good news in thinking about how to shift and where to shift spending is that all of the areas I mentioned actually create more jobs than would be lost by cutting military spending. And so the main takeaway I hope for us all to leave with tonight is that military spending does create jobs, of course it does, but all of these other areas create more jobs, and that military spending is not necessary for job creation. That military spending, we hear the old story over and over, we have to have military spending because, jobs are maintained throughout the country. There's military spending in just about every congressional district. And so there is always a fear of job loss when we talk about cutting the military budget. But, basically the only thing we could do worse would be to shift military spending into fossil fuels, which creates even fewer jobs. But if we shifted it into any of these other areas, clean energy, healthcare, infrastructure, education, all of these create more jobs than would be lost by cutting military spending. So I won't go into the modeling tonight, but in short, I use something called an input-output model, which is a way to capture all the linkages in the economy, how businesses buy and sell from each other and to each other, and how businesses sell to the government and to consumers. And so we can capture both the direct jobs that are created in any industry and the jobs created throughout the supply chain, the indirect jobs. And if we look at that economy-wide picture, direct and indirect jobs, military spending creates about 7 jobs per $1 million of spending, or 7,000 jobs per $1 billion of spending. Clean energy and infrastructure create close to 10 jobs for the same amount of spending. Healthcare creates more than 14 jobs, education more than 15 jobs. So for the same amount of spending, whether we're talking, you know, a million or a billion or 100 billion, clean energy and infrastructure create 40% more jobs than the military. Healthcare creates 100%, education 120% more. And just to put that same information visually, you can see for every $1 million that we cut the military budget, we would lose 7 jobs, but we would gain 10 jobs in clean energy or infrastructure. We'd gain 2 jobs in healthcare for every job lost in the military if we were shifting from one to the other. So thinking more about a $200 billion shift from military to green, the Cost of War Project co-director, Nita Crawford, she'll be putting out another paper this year after the new budget numbers are released by the Biden administration. But her most recent paper came out in late 2019, and it shows the cost of the post 9/11 wars totaling $6.4 trillion if we include future obligations for veterans. It's $5.4 trillion of spending between 2001 and late 2019. So if we looked at what that average cost is for the post 9/11 wars, that comes out to about $270 billion a year. So simply ending war spending, and of course it's a little bit lower now, but ending war spending and shifting $200 billion to green growth would lower emissions by 40% over 20 years and would also create close to 2 million jobs. And again, this is this presentation will be available. These are hyperlinked. So if you want to look at any of the papers, these will be linked in the PowerPoint. And the 2 million jobs numbers come from a paper I wrote with the Cost of War Project in 2019, looking at the job creating effects. And then if we look at the net job change, so how many jobs we gain in clean energy versus how many we would lose by cutting that amount of spending in the military, the net change would be about 600,000 jobs gained by shifting $200 billion from military to green. I was very happy to see Laura talk about the just transition. One thing to think about in shifting from military to green is where are those job losses going to occur? Because even though in aggregate, in total, the jobs gained are much greater than jobs lost, for individuals and communities who are losing those jobs, there will be difficulties. Some workers will need retraining or relocation assistance. Some workers may need to retire, may have difficulty finding new jobs. Thinking about targeting green investments in those communities that are most likely to face job loss would be one aspect. And other aspects of a green, of a just transition,
I'm just letting you know we have like 2 more minutes.
Oh, great. All right, that'll be plenty.
Awesome.
Thank you. So thinking about targeting green investments to those communities and individuals that would be hardest hit. I won't go in detail, but there's a lot of occupational overlap, in fact, between military occupations and green and infrastructure occupations. So if you look at enlisted personnel working in electronics and electrical equipment repair, engineering, science, technical occupations, transportation, vehicle and machinery mechanics, all of these are occupations that are needed in the green economy. All of these are occupations that are also needed in infrastructure design and repair. And the Department of Labor offers some resources for veterans or people in military occupations transitioning to the civilian sector and looking at where there's overlap between military occupations and green occupations. So I will end on this slide and just highlight some takeaways. The main thing is that cutting military spending could actually create jobs if the funds are shifted into other domestic spending priorities, including clean energy. That job loss might occur for some individuals or will occur for some individuals and communities, and we need to think about a just transition. And overall, we just need to counter the old narrative that military spending is necessary for jobs. So I'll end there, and I encourage you to to check out various papers at the Cost of War website.
Our third speaker is Betta Broad. Betta is the campaign director of New Yorkers for Clean Power, the director of advocacy and organizing at the Association for Energy Affordability, and I'm happy to say a member of the board of Brooklyn for Peace. She will present on the interconnected crises of endless wars, climate emergency and inequality, and for those people who are now anxious to take action, we'll suggest some action that you can take to support these goals.
I am going to introduce Brooklyn for Peace's new climate action campaign. So I'm going to share my screen here. And don't be too horrified about my very messy desktop. Can you see it? Okay. So Brooklyn for Peace has a new website. We have a new climate action campaign that we're launching as we speak, which is very exciting. And really appreciate you all being a part of it. We have a petition that I'm going to go over in a minute with you, but first I just want to show you this new brochure that is on the climate action page of our website. That's really a fantastic resource. That was a collaborative effort. You can kind of go to it from the page. When you don't have Laura and Heidi available, you can use this as a resource to share with people about these interconnected crises and raise awareness about the importance of building this interconnected movement. So I'll take us through it quickly. Again, I don't want to be repetitive, because a lot of this was already covered, but I just want to at least introduce you to it and of course give just another thank you to our graphic designer who volunteered and put this together, Chris Brunt, and the great team of volunteers that worked on it, and Ed Goldman, who's out there, who created a flyer about wars and global warming a while ago through Fort Greenpeace and helped to lay the groundwork for some of our work with Brooklyn for Peace. So clearly, we covered this. The military is the number one user of fossil fuels, producer of carbon dioxide. We went over the egregious spending, the bloated Pentagon budget, the 800 plus bases. Does this look familiar to anyone? Unfortunately, it's not familiar to a lot of Americans. I don't think most people realize how much of our federal budget is going to the military, but everybody at this meeting now knows because you've seen it three times. And of course, again, what we've already been talking about, that we could be investing in public health care and education and housing and transportation and the need to address climate change, which is the focus of tonight. Laura touched on this, but we again, wanted to highlight that it's, not just about the bloated Pentagon budget. It's also about the environmental degradation that happens with US wars abroad and the type of toxic waste and deforestation that occurs with our current foreign policy agenda, and so we want to see a reverse of that and instead be investing in diplomacy, in public health, in the kinds of investments that are going to truly create a more peaceful and sustainable world. Laura talked about this, climate change being a threat multiplier. I'm not sure if you mentioned this, Laura, but the Defense Department has done a lot of research into how climate change is a major threat to US security. We would agree there. We might not necessarily have the same solution to that issue, but it certainly is a major threat to our country and our world stability. You know, again, contributing to refugees, climate change, and militarism are eroding our social safety net. And poor people are suffering the most from environmental degradation, both caused by war and fossil fuel extraction. We know that in neighborhoods in New York City, like the South Bronx, we have, which are disproportionately people of color, we have, you know, people suffering from asthma, from other diseases. And this occurs, you know, all over the world where we have disproportionate impacts from the fossil fuel industry. We know people in the global South who are suffering disproportionately, as well as people in coastal regions in our country, including New York. So when we created this slideshow originally, or this brochure, as we call it, we had a focus on the Green New Deal. We still want to support a Green New Deal agenda, of course. We want to shift our priorities, as we've been talking about. We had, at the end of this year, when we, Chris designed this for us, a focus on rejoining the Paris Climate Agreement. Thankfully, that's done. That was a success. So thank you, President Biden. And so at this point, I'm going to actually go back to the original petition that I mentioned, because our slideshow needs to be updated. We're going to be doing that very we're going to be doing that soon, but I wanted to show it to you just as a really great resource and a tool that you can use, you know, in your outreach efforts or sharing with your friends or family. I think Brooklyn for Peace would also be happy with meeting with, you know, a community group of yours. But in the meantime, something everyone can do is click to sign this letter. And this is directed to the congressional delegation from Brooklyn, all of the representatives from Brooklyn, because this is Brooklyn for Peace. I know there's people on here from all over, and this is part of a growing national movement, of course, but because we're Brooklyn for Peace, we have this focus, and to our senators, Senator Schumer and Senator Gillibrand. So we basically lay out in this letter a lot of what we've talked about, and also highlight the legislation that was introduced by Barbara Lee that Laura and Heidi both mentioned to reduce the budget, the Pentagon budget, by 10%. And there was a recent letter by 50 House Democrats urging President Biden to, you know, to cut the budget, the military budget. And so our top actions are to back up Senator Schumer's call for a climate emergency. I don't know if people heard that Senator Schumer did make statements about that, which is great. We agree, we're in a climate emergency, and we think President Biden should declare one and then take it one step further by redirecting Pentagon funds and troops to mitigate global warming and make America more resilient. We want our congressional representatives to join the Defense Spending Reduction Caucus. Many of the Brooklyn reps did sign on to Barbara Lee's historic legislation to reduce the Pentagon budget by 10%, but this is the next level of action to show commitment. It's joining this Defense Spending Reduction Caucus and really get serious about this. We want to reduce the carbon polluting activities of the military by just decreasing its scope and shrinking the budget. And of course, we want to support a Green New Deal. And the Thrive Act, which some people might be familiar with, it's kind of a new, exciting coalescing of a number of different environmental, EJ, labor, peace groups to push for a just and equitable transition off fossil fuels and creating millions of unionized jobs, family sustaining green jobs. And you can find out more if you want to just Google Thrive Act. And we're also going to be sending a follow-up email to after this presentation with a link to this petition, although I urge you to please sign it now. And we'll can also include a link to the Thrive Act so you can check out more details about that. But you can sign yourself as an individual. You can also sign on behalf of your organization. And our plan is to keep building this this petition, this movement, and make sure that our representatives know that their constituents feel strongly about this connection and reducing our military budget and investing in a green economy.
I do want to highlight that Black people, Black folks in the United States disproportionately join the military. Like they join the military at higher rates. A lot of Black people live in urban areas, but most Black people live in the South, which like you might be surprised to hear. And encouraging better job opportunities for Black and Brown folk is for labor, which is like not the military, where you'll probably end up with PTSD and like a lot of issues. That's important too. I think, and this is just me as a person speaking, and please Heidi and Betta and Laura, please bring in your expertise. I think that Black folk and folk who, and other marginalized folk who have investment and stake in the military in terms of livelihood, in terms of opportunity, it's really important to think what it means for them or what it would mean for them to change course and what they would need to be successful or to be just as stable. Unionization is another mm-hmm. part of it. Like unionization has been proven to help marginalized people and moving the epicenter of opportunity from the military to unionization is definitely something that can be looked into. But I'm sure Laura, Heidi, and Betta have like more thorough, and Chris probably have more thorough information on that.
Yeah, I'll just say really quickly and then I'll leave space for others. I really appreciate that point, Natasha, and I think that's really critical. And I think, yeah, the reality is right now the sort of only major federal jobs program in the United States is the US military, right? The only sort of, for many people, this is a pathway to the middle class, a pathway out of poverty, a pathway to education. And so that's why, you know, Heidi's data is so important, because the reality is that having the military be the major federal jobs program is not only harmful in all sorts of ways, it's also just not even the most cost-effective way to create jobs, right? And so that's a part of why it's really important to use those federal resources to create jobs that aren't rooted in the militarism, because the reality is federal spending is siloing people into those limited opportunities.
So I'll add on to what Natasha and Laura both said about thinking about the pipeline from education to jobs and the pipeline from poverty to the middle class. And, you know, as I like how it was just put, that the military is the only federal jobs program we have. And so we need to think about, how do we create labor demand? How do we create a need for workers of all different skill levels in something like the green economy, in infrastructure, in education? How, you know, in the green economy in particular, there's so much room for building that out and for creating a need for engineers and, you know, lawyers and accountants and production workers and transportation workers and all kinds of different skill levels and educational backgrounds, and countering the pull that the military has, and also countering the pull that contractors have. So some of the work, I put out a paper last year looking at contracting, what I call the camo economy, because contracting hides all kinds of things. It hides costs. It hides the fact that we're at war because we use so many contractors in war zones. And so it camouflages a lot from public view. But one of the things that I found there is that there's really a wage premium that contractors can offer, because they make such big profits off of military contracts. They can offer higher than average wages for engineers and for technicians and for all kinds of different occupations. Someone coming out of college, coming out of, you know, with an engineering degree, finds it much more attractive to go to a place like Raytheon or Lockheed Martin than they do to go work for a new clean energy firm, unless really their heart is in it. But if you look at the pay scale, it's very different. So having, you know, federal procurement, buying green products, creating a demand for green jobs will help to boost the need for those jobs, and also will create a balance to both the military and to military contractors who right now provide really attractive employment opportunities.
And I just want to echo sort of everyone's sentiments around that last question around timelines. And just, I think that that question in and of itself really demonstrates how much we need movement, right? It's so clear that the sort of status quo in Washington and amongst people in power, amongst politicians, is far from where we need to be as it relates to the rate and the ambition of societal transformation in order to counter the climate crisis. And a critical part of that transformation is demilitarization. And so I'm very hopeful to have this conversation and with so many people. I encourage folks to organize with Brooklyn for Peace or wherever you live, because it really is movements that are gonna make what we need possible politically. Movements will really move the needle. So keep doing, keep organizing.